When do you cut? Great. Your field is now ready and you're already looking for stem. By the time the stems come to you and you start them again for another 1 or 2 weeks, there's a big problem there. Which means that there must be an understanding between where your farm will be ready and when you should start cutting your stems to plant. There's a strong need for you to estimate the quantity of stems that you need. And I will explain to you why. You have a 1 acre farm and you did not realize that you need 60 bundles to plant the 1 acre. And somebody tells you you can purchase stems from a farm there. You go there with a truck and you only pick 40 bundles. You bring it back, you plant, and you now need to go back a second time. Double that position. You're going to cross on the board. You shoot up. You must go for best practices that will help you to reduce your cost of transportation. Tools for cutting. Yes, our farmers may pick up this stem, put it on the handboot, and cut. At the point you put your stem on any hard surface and cut it, you have reduced your yield by 25%. Automatically. Because right from that onset, you would have damaged the lower part of this stem. And this damaged part may not produce roots. Alright? And unless you have enough roots to produce, your yields will drop. There's a correlation between number of roots produced and yield. We'll soon show you that. So if you look at here for example, look at this stem here. Look at the number of roots here produced. Look at this stem here. Look at the number of roots produced. You can never compare the yields at harvest time. It is utmostly impossible. So what would you do to ensure that your stem gives you at least 25 roots during the first 3 weeks? You can guarantee that your yields will be high. And we all put on this one. Very good. Now, someone will say, what you are saying, how can I achieve it on farm? How do I get that to happen? Because now I can cut my stake. Stake one, stake two, for planting. And someone now may say, then our farmers is not classes, so how can they achieve this? I will say, don't worry, you can really achieve it. Instead of making farmers to put their stems on a hard surface to cut, or they tell their children or neighbor, put the stem in the soil and then cut it. If you ask yourself why farmers do that, you will know the challenges they've had in the past, and you will know why that will not continue. Because as you put it in the end, what you cut, you don't even know the measure of the length in the end. Alright? And at the point of cut, you seldom will get a smooth cut. Let me tell you why it's important for you to have a smooth cut. If you look at this bag and you cut it open, there are three parts to it. There are three parts. There's this brown part, brown, see it, this brown one. It's made up of dead cells. And it is protective in nature. It's the one that's protecting the green one inside. This green one you see, this green one here, that is the fluid. Elementary biology. This is a fluid, that's a fluid. Right? This green one you're seeing, that's a good. This wood you are seeing here, that is iron. And so, when cassava begins to produce its food in the leaves, the food is translocated through this green part you are seeing, down to the roots to be stored for you. Any damage to that fluid will reduce your yield. Are we getting it? The wooden mat here is inside them. Yeah. And that's the one that does what? Brings in water from the soil to the leaves so that photosynthesis will take place, food is produced before it's translocated down. In between this phloem and this xylem is a slimy substance here, which we call the cambium. That's the cambium. And that is the one that divides to produce the callous cells here that will give you the roots. As a result, you can never find roots on the ordinary body like this. No way. You can only find roots around this space, the space between the fluid and the xylem. That is where you find the roots build up from. You can equally find roots from this nodal point where you have meristematic cells. Are we all getting this? Now, when nature has said, nature has told you, the Moshe Dai Genre, Moshe Dari, a mortal die. If you want it to give you good yield, don't recreate it. You must leave this protective cover on the fluent and leave the fluent on the xylem if you want it to give you a good yield. So now to get this on par, what do we recommend? Tell the farmers to make a mound for you, a soft mound, maybe clayey or sandy loam. Put the stem on the mound, use a sharp cutlass to cut it. The cutlass will enter the soil and there's no pressure coming back. You have a clay cut. Are we getting this? If you put the stem in the soil, who knows why that practice started? The practice of putting stem in the soil started to address the need for correct planting. When you cut stems this way, the stems have what? Nodes. Each of the nodes has what? Eyes, the meristematic point. That's the point that will grow into a new life. Every node has it. Now, what you find is that when parents cut their stems this way, their children are not able to immediately identify the eyes. So when they are planting, sometimes they plant upside down. When you plant upside down, because of the polarization in cassava, roots will never come from this other part. Osheshe. Roots can only come from this distal part. So once you force it down, you've killed that plant. It will never give you any economic yield. Never. That is even if it survives. So parents have observed that. Put it in the soil, cut it. Put it in the soil, cut it. That was how the technology started. But now they're not asking themselves, what are the damages doing? Because it has damages. So helping them to get the yield they should, because they are not getting the type of surface they need to make the kind of cells produce and form the roots for them. So the yields continue to drop. Are we not getting this? So if you then look at this here, if you cut this correctly, you're going to have a flush of roots from here because of the kind of cell development. And then from the nodal point. So if you have up to 25 roots from the stick planted, the chances are high that plant, during tuber formation, they give you up to 8 tubers. Because the plant can never convert all the roots into tubers. No, it needs roots to bring in water for its survival. But the plant needs water more than it needs its food. Because food is the product. So it needs more water. And therefore, it will never give you it can never give you roots that will affect its ability to bring in water on the soil. So now we say, encourage the stems to produce enough roots so that it can give you enough tubers. Now, we will show you how that happens very soon. But as long as continue to cut wrongly, even on some farms, they do like this. and water it. Farmers, they hold it over for jar. And you want to get editors. Oh, it's not possible. Right? So quickly, let's look at length of stakes. Length of stakes, there is no problem at all with this. Because every node has its own life. If you cut your stem to have one node, it will germinate. It is proud for you, it is proud. Are we all following this? Now, Ben's, when cassava sprouts from a node, during the first 4 weeks, this baby is depending on the mother. It's like a newborn baby. This new plant is depending on the mother that you planted. So the question now is, what size of mother can provide food for this baby for those first 4 weeks? So if you use this small sticks, they're going to have very weak babies because it's too small to provide the food that they need. And science now has shown that anything from 20 centimeters will give you the length of stem that can provide enough food for this growing baby. That was how the recommendation that you should use was 20 centimeters, 25 centimeters, that's it. So if you are using fat stems like this, you can use what? 20 cm. If they are thinner, you can use 22, 25. And I'll be able to sustain this baby. Are we following up on this one? Now you have your steps. And the next point now that somebody is raising is have I plant? Alright? Have I plant? Should I plant at an angle? Should I plant flat? Should I plant vertical? The output, depending on your location and your soil type. Right? Now, but what does each planting orientation require? If you have a very clay soil, and you plant vertical on that soil, at harvest time, you are going to request for Panadol and ask to be able to open the soil for the roots to come. If you have a sandy loam soil like we have around, it's recommended that you do what? You plant incline at an angle. Why? Why did inclining stem start? Because when you incline stems, you are telling the cassava, push all your roots in front. Because when your roots are in front, when I want to harvest you, I will push here, push a lever, and the roots will all come out. That's the message. So you're trying to reduce your harvesting cost. That's why you said plant at an angle. Sorry about your tuber size or what have you. No, it's not. Now, if you go to Benue, Southern Kogi, what have you? Exactly. Some of the soils are very sandy. If you go to Badagry, where the soils are very sandy, they will never plant at an angle in Badagry. They will never. They will always plant how? Straight. Because when you plant straight, what you are telling cassava is what? Produce your roots round the base for me. Not keep it in front. Produce the roots round the base so that the root will spread and the plant will start. So that during the heavy rain and there's windy storm, alright, you come on me, it will not launch. Are we following this? So you get the farmer's field. And the plants are always lodging. You should know the practice. You should know why. Check out such fields. The soils are sandy. That's number one. Or number two, they are planting them with shadow. Those two. Right? So, again, when we're discussing the need for you to make ridges or mounds, have you observed that when some farmers make mounds, they spend money. 800 naira, 2000 naira to make Iba Abi, one quarter, one pin, If I told you bad day, 3 months down the line, if I don't go in the way anymore, Jerome Mopani. Exactly. When the race have started, you go back to that same field, it's almost flat. Why did you make the mount? Why? Tell me. Why? On such fields, if you plant on the flat, your yields are the same thing. They're the same thing. So everything you spent making those mounts, wasted, increasing cost of what? Production. That's just it. So every step you take on your farm must have an economic reason for you. You must know why. Otherwise, you will eventually. Right? Great. So if you plant flat like this, there's a message that you're telling cassava. If you plant flat, you are saying, hey, wow, the food I have around you is high enough. My soil is very, very fertile. So because of that, I allow you to bring out as many children as you can. If you plant it flat, you are saying, don't limit your children. Bring out as many children as you can. When you plant, you have to see that this one will sprout, this will sprout, this will sprout, this will sprout. Many of them will sprout out. When that happens, all the children now will be depending on the same food there. So if your soil is not fertile, avoid wahala. Are we getting this? You must never plant flat on a soil that is not fertile enough. You must never plant flat. Never. If you plant it vertically, you are saying the same thing. Let only one or two come up, all the others should do what? Sleep. Once you keep it this way, you've broken the dominance. You are saying, don't worry, all of you should do what? Go. This you can only do if your soil is what? Better. And I will again quickly use, please come again, come from consulting. A very quick analogy. Because these are the things you see on farmer's field, and you're able to guide them up. So the two of us are here. Let's say this and mommy here. Alright? I have 11 children. He has 3 children. As a mother, she has only 2 congos of rice. She gives 1 congo to him, 1 congo to me. Where will the children eat very well? Where will children go to university? Where will you have mechanics? What Shane Berry said, if you plant wrongly where the soil cannot sustain the life of many children, your yields will drop significantly. Because every child that comes up here will have his own roots and produce his own tubers. At the end of the day, you have so much where no she's there, and so many tubers that are not marketable. And for you to make an economic value of them, you must do what? Leave them to grow for about 18 months. That's right here, they start waiting for 18 months before you can begin to harvest. Is that clear to us now? So please keep that one in mind. Very well. Let's quickly go to the next one, still running for time. So we've tried to explain this to us. Don't damage your flame or cambium. Enable them to operate optimally for you. Use the right length of stake. Use the right tools for cutting. You need just about 60 bundles of cassava per hectare. Don't damage the relationship that God has created to give us the best of years. Next slide, let's quickly. So let's begin to put all of this together. Right? When you plant cassava, we want to look at some of the key areas here again. You can plant cassava any time of the year in Nigeria. Are you following? You can plant cassava any time of the year in Nigeria. However, just ensure that after planting, you have 60 days of moist soil. No one can guarantee that you're okay. So, if for anybody to say you can plant in May, you can plant in, assuming there's climate change, assuming there's a prolonged drought, once you don't have 60 days of moist soil after planting, your cassava will not do well. And if you can plant in Ogun State, people plant during 2 seasons. Early rainy season and late rainy season. They have reasons. Alright? And I tried to explain this to you earlier on. Any rainy season, The best time to plant is when there is a balance between your soil temperature and your moisture level in soil. There must be that balance. And this is why you say that people want to plant between what? March and April. Or so sometimes May. Again. About in what? June. Go to tomorrow. Or soil temperature will do what? Go down. And soil moisture will do what? Come up when you plant your roots, your stems will rot in the soil. They will rot. So when you have so much water in the soil, we advise that you do not plant, don't go by this conventional slanted cutting that you force the stems inside. No, keep it close to the top of the ridge for you so that there's enough sunlight that will build up the temperature that will spike the production of your roots for you. Otherwise, no results. Are we getting this one now? Very good. So those who like planting late season, don't try to ask questions. Because if you say I'll plant in October and you are so unlucky that rain season is very early in October, your plant may not have 60 days of moist soil and your yield will drop. I can assure you of that. Orientation, vertical, horizontal, incline, we'll try to explain this to ourselves. Population of spacing. We say right on time, we always tell ourselves that what? The cassava should be planted 1 meter by 1 meter, isn't it?
Yes.
We agree. Today we are saying 1 meter by 0.8. But the fact is, still remains that it is still 1 meter by 1 meter. And why is this so? When you plant 1 meter by 1 meter, you're going to have 10,000 plants per hectare. True or false?
Yes.
Correct. Now, who is that magician who will plant 10,000? And 10,000 will survive. It's not possible, it's tough. So we've done calculations to realize that usually farmers lose about what? 20% of that play down. But we know, you and I know that for you to harvest good yield, you need to have near 10,000 plants per hectare. If you have 10,000 plants per hectare, it means that if each plant gives you 1 kg, what's your yield? What's your yield? At 1 kg per plant, what's your yield? That's 10 tons. At 2 kg per plant, what's your yield? 20 tons. At 3 kg per plant, what's your yield? 30 tons. Are we getting this? So, because the 10,000 therefore refers to plant population at harvest. Not at planting. It's plant population at harvest. You must harvest 10,000 plants per hectare. If that is the case, you cannot plant 10,000. So we reduce it to what? 1 by 0.8, so that you plant 10,500. That way, I'm a lay cool, you'll get that of me. Are we getting this? So every time I begin to wait, you have your explanations for everything that you are doing. Now, question of stakes. Very frequently, you will see that our farmers make mounds, are they? They make mounds. When you make a mound, both farmers have the practice of planting on top of the mound. And planting on top of the mound, they get inclined the stem. Wrong practice. Because what they are telling the plant is, when I incline you, I want you to push your tubers and roots in front for me, isn't it? Exactly. So now this is your mound that has no limits. You then plant inclined on it. Then the plant will produce the roots around the surface of the mound. And when the farmer comes with the hose and is within the plant, is destroying the roots of cassava, then the shocks will begin on the plant and the yields will do what? Down. Down. So any family that made mounds must plant from behind their mound. Can't plant on top. Are we following here? So that the roots are encapped in the middle of the mound where no hole or blade gets to. It's very important if you want to keep your ear. Now, nobody says you cannot intercrop. Let anybody tell you that. If you want to do monocrop, you're welcome. If you think you want to intercrop with maize, what they are saying is, don't let maize stop cassava. Don't let cassava stop maize. Never a single thing. But now, because cassava is your main crop, since it will be there for a longer time than maize, then you must respect the planting density of cassava. You must respect that. Are we in agreement with this one? So you have to plant your cassava at what? 1 meter by 0.8. That's standard for it. Because it is your main crop. You then bring in your maize. Your maize is now what? The intercrop. You cannot use the standard spacing for maize and a monocrop in an intercrop. No. And for cassava now we say use the same spacing for cassava. So here now you have one cassava is here, another one is here, and this is the ridge or what have you. Now we are saying for your maize, put maize in between these two on this side. The next one on this side, stagger. When they come up, there will be very little interference. Your maize will do well, that will do well, and you will harvest very good yields. Are we clear on that? We are saying, do not fuss. Now, you are taking time. Watch what children do, or those who are employed to work for you on the farm. They take the cassava on your field. Back, isn't it? And they are forcing it through the soil, except you are lucky that rains are going to just fall in. The soil particles are always hard, and they will bruise all this end. So the relationship between the phloem design will be broken, root production will be disturbed, and your yields will drop. Now, if you will plant cassava without using herbicide, I'm happy that we are discussing with harvesting, we have a field. We are looking at using pre-emergence herbicides. Great. But where farmers will not use pre-emergence herbicides, the advice is that you cut the stems about 1 week before you plant. Cut the stems of your farm about a week before you plant. And the question will be why? Good. If this is your farm that you know will be ready in 1 week, look for a shade, maybe a tree. Cut your stems there. Look for palm frond or any material and cover it up. 1 week after planting, if you pick up this, you will see that the nodes have already started sprouting for you. The carbon cells here would have formed already. Are we getting this?
No, sir.
Madam, yes. Now, we are saying, if you want to harvest very good yield, now the first thing you want to do is to ensure that the plant produces enough roots at the base for you. To ensure that this happens, send these stems to the nursery school before you put them in primary school. And what's the nursery school now? Right on that your farm where you plant them, let farmers cut the stems into planting size for you under shade. Let them cover it up. The high temperature and humidity will force the shoots to begin to sprout. These ones are not sprouted yet. Alright? They will start sprouting. Two things that this will do for you. When people are to plant for you, they've seen the sprout, they know how to plant for you. Number two is that it has already encouraged the production of the carbon cells here. So root production is what? Very, very fast. Number three is if your land is where you have termite problems. Termites will damage your field. If you leave cassava unprotected on that field, During the 1 week it will stay before it begins to sprout, termites will go inside and damage it. Termites does not usually damage actively growing plants. If you resprout, you've already initiated the growth. If you then transplant, the transplanting, you just hold your cutlass, open the ground, just drop it, don't force it. Just drop it. If you drop it, the rate of growth is so, within 3 days, you come there, you won't believe it. The shoots are out already. And so if it's a termite laden field, the damage on your stems is lower compared with when you do not resprout. Termites damage because of the time it takes the shoot to produce its sprout. So it's a function of what you have there. Alright? Great. So we have looked at this one now. So like I said, if you pre-sprout it, it has some value. But if you know you will use pre-emergence herbicides, like the Mestra, do not pre-sprout. Because the machine pan go for me, not your pilot, your pan. So in that case, you just need to manage your temperatures and soil humidity, which if you plant cassava now at this temperature, you will get very good results. Just cut it neatly, plant it, and you're very okay. Point number two, especially if you're not going to maintain the 12,500 plant population. Every plant on your farm that dies is a loss to you. It's a loss. Because you spend money making that up. Don't allow it. So what this means is that if you come to your field 1 week after planting, and you find snakes that have refused to come on, please. Not just, let's say 8 to 9 days. If they not come on, please replace them. Don't say that they are beginning to come on. They begin to come up, there's something delaying their growth. They are slow, and that slowness will continue in their lives. So don't say, but is she, but you don't do Matombo. You know. There is something fundamental that's not beginning to grow as fast as the other one. Just replace it. But what should you replace it with? A fresh cutting? No. If you replace with a fresh cutting, there's a differential already created there. So it means at the point you finish planting, tell the farmers, let them go to one spot on their farm, let them put like maybe up to 50 there. Put about 50, it will help them. Alright? When you come back and you find those that are very weak, after a good rainfall, just gently bring them out, go there and put them. They will catch up in growth. They will. Are we getting this? Every mound, every ridge must pay for its cost. Any plant that dies on a mound will not make you not to be that. You must be that mound. You must be it. So you must ensure that every plant survives. Every plant survives on your field. You can never fail. Because even if it's just 1 kg, there is that end up. Come on, regarding 1 kg per plant, don't you go to your target is minimum of what? 30 tons, 3 kg. And what is 3 kg? Hello, 3 kg. You know, better be marrying you, or 3 kg. Marry you, right? Why won't we get this on the plant? Why? Why? We told you what you need to do. Once you do that, you must get this. You must get it. Must. Let's now see why, another reason why you may not get sufficient tubers. When you all get to your fields, just enter any farm, harvest 10 plants. Count the number of tubers you find on each plant. They'll be different. Some may give you 10, 15, some may give you 6, some may give you 2, some may give you 1. Now, when you plant cassava, during that from the 6 to 7 weeks, if you don't weed your farm, if you don't weed it, the weed begins to compete with the plant. And cassava does not like to be shaded. Go to any weed cassava farm. You will see the head of cassava showing up. You see it. It will always want to fight for light. So, during that 6 to 7 weeks, when the food is producing, to go down to open up bank accounts for you. If you keep it under wheat, what will happen? It will channel the food to be growing tall. And so there are no tubers form for you. So, you then come and you win the farm, you win it and you see the greenish planetary line. So okay, in your mind you say, ah, there's no problem, they will recover. They are not recovering for you, because the damage has been done. They did not produce any bank account for you. So you win it, it's clean. 2 months after you come, the plants are looking great now, but there's nothing for you. Economically, it will not pay and give you anything. So these are big errors that all of us make. And this is why we are saying, very, very careful. Right? Good. Next one. Harvesting, yeah, there's nothing too special here. But let me just ask us, if a farmer comes to you and says, I want to supply tubers and tubers to other Atlantis. My cassava has already gone through, it's already 1 year that I planted cassava. Is that why you ask them to go and harvest? The answer is no. Because when the plant is 1 year, let's quickly do the analysis. Depends on when you plant it. If you plant in March, March the next year, your plants will be what? 1 year old. If you plant in August the next year, your plants will be 1 year. Now, let me give us the facts here. If you plant in March and you harvest in March the next year, and it's only 1 year, your yield will be lower compared if you plant in August and you harvest in August next year. Two different yields. Why is that so? Cassava has two key bulking seasons. Two key bulking seasons. The first bulking season is when the first 3 months to 4 months, when the leaves are very young, right, and they are photosynthetically active. They are very, very active. So if you plant in March, the plants come up. You see that between that April, May, June, July, August, September, it's active. Once you go into the dry season and the water level in the soil drops, the plant begins to go into dormancy. There's no increase in yield between November and March the next year. There's always no increase in yield at that time. Because that's when the plant has gone through serious stress. And some of them will have done what? They will have dropped the leaves. That dropping leaves is what is a resist. Yes. It's going to help it to reduce the pool of water from the soil, which will force it to begin to utilize its tubers. Are we getting this? So it means that plant has had only one active bulking season. The second bulking season starts when the rains begin now, and the plant begins to produce new fresh lots of leaves. That second one. So that one again goes from about that April, May, June. Are you getting me? So when you harvest in March, because you planted in March previous year, which is only 1 year, your return on investment is low. We advise to leave it for another 3 months so you can take advantage of the new plot of the year. Are we getting this? Point number two here is that around that February, March, because for the plants to produce a new flush of leaves, it must convert the starch in the tubers into glucose. Starch is not mobile. Starch is immobile. The starch in the tubers cannot go to the leaves to help the plant produce new leaves. The starch must be converted into what? Glucose. And the glucose will now mobilize and go up here to supply food to the leaves, and the plant begin to produce new leaves. During that time, your root dry matter will be what? Low. Because starch has been converted into glucose. Are we getting this? Then I should gari on my yo Monday for me. Your gari now is not very good gari, it's not. Dry matter in cassava now is low. Because cassava has done what? Reflushed, has moved starch, converts into sugar and is using it now to do what? To produce new leaves. If you supply your tubers to ADM or any major company, they will refuse you. They will refuse you. Because they want to pay by what? Level of starch content. They will refuse you. I don't know if this is getting clear to us. Again, you know, similar to what you observed in yams. Those of us who know that issue again, man, don't have issue again. So when I'm doing, right? When you keep yams in your kitchen and the yams begin to break dormancy and they begin to produce a sprout instead of beans, then I game it and say, hey, bad news. Do your model. And why? Because the yam has converted starch into glucose. So if you like it, it's very, very tasty, very sweet. The starch content has dropped. So for those who are suffering from diabetes, if you need to eat yam, the best one to go for is issue again that has converted starch into, because the starch content then is what? Low. You have more sugar. Are we all getting this? Great. So now you want to tell the farmer when to harvest. You can't just say because my plant is 1 year, you can't harvest. No. No. My advice is that before you harvest any field, you know that, you know, you need anything above 20 tons for the farmer to break even. If the farmer plans to harvest maybe in June, when it is April or early May, go to that field randomly, harvest like five plants randomly. They check here, they wait, they go back in any one or two. If you come back in June and you harvest five plants and you see an increase in yield, the plants are still gone. Therefore, if you harvest that time, you will lose. You don't harvest your field to sell when the plants are still bulking for you, increasing your yield for you. Don't do that. Are we all getting this? The best time for you to harvest is when the relative increase in yield is low. Slow. So please, all these things will help you know what to do and how to guide a family.